we are continuing to be caught in the middle of an attempted communist Bolshevik Zionist overthrow of the United States of America. Disagree? You don't have to listen. That's how it looks to yours truly and the multitude of people who listen to this program. This is an attempted coup d'etat. No doubt, no other possible way to interpret what's going on. The lies, the deceit, the fiction, the fraud, the federal felony criminality is over the top. It's crazy. And when you see the news go up shortly, you'll understand. DB has a marvelous story up. I put that at the top of headlines earlier today. We've got things from C.J. Hopkins, all manner of people. Brother Nathaniel just put out a completely fact-based analysis of how everything is being run, as only Brother Nathaniel can do. And he did it. We have another story about Rupert Murdoch. All the Murdoch-owned media has turned on President Trump, urging him to cooperate with the regime coup that has been prepared against America. Even Laura Ingraham appears to have stabbed Trump in the back in the story. You'll see it. Was she threatened? I wouldn't be the least surprised. You want to keep your job? We need you to step on board with this general attitude toward President Trump. This is going to be very interesting. This being Saturday's million-person march from the Supreme Court to the White House. I'm expecting a huge turnout. I hope we see it. There'll be a lot of efforts to disarm Americans, make them sit back and not express their feelings, but this could be an unprecedented day in American history. We'll find out very soon. Lawsuits are being filed all over the place. More than 10,000 now dead people somehow clawed their way out of the ground over their cremation urns and voted in Michigan. Think about that. Then we have the poor guy in Pennsylvania, the USPS employee, who was talked to by Project Veritas and who signed an affidavit that his superior ordered him to backdate ballots. He has suddenly recanted. Think he might have been threatened. Nah, not a chance, huh? 10 states' attorneys general have joined the Supreme Court case now against Pennsylvania's mail-in ballot deadline. The Supreme Court is going to have its hands very full very quickly. All right, with that, there's a whole lot more to talk about, and up first tonight is the brilliant Mike McGill from Liberty Gold and Silver. Hello, Mike. Welcome back.
Hey, Jeff. It's great to be back, but under these circumstances, I don't know what I'm back from or where we're going to. You know, it's like, we're living in dystopian times, literally. And if you don't mind, I don't like to get too personal, but I like to share an experience that happened to me over the weekend, if you don't mind.
No, I don't mind.
Well, here's what had to happen. I have a younger daughter who's having some problems, but she's fighting very, very well against them and doing well. And I felt she needed a little encouragement, so I decided I'd get on a plane and let's see, when I go down there. Saturday, I would fly down and fly down in the morning into Las Vegas, spend Saturday afternoon, Sunday all day, and Monday morning till midday afternoon, and come back on a plane. And I also, while I was down there, I promised I'd meet a gentleman who's going to do some sponsorship for our plane, Cuff. I met him, and that was very successful, and that part was cool, and it was great to be with my kid and all that.
Yeah.
But other than that, you
went off to Las Vegas with your daughter to have a good time, just to get the hell out of town for a few days, do something different. You were down there not too long ago, if I don't...
We had a grandchild down there, and I went down, she's having some problems, and not bad, but I just felt I was critical that I share some support, so I went down. So it's very interesting. I haven't flown on a plane for about 3.5 years, and I hardly ever fly any of them, so I had to take my significant other on a vacation once, and she needed it, and so I haven't that since about 3.5 years. I think it was 5 or 6 years before that, because I don't like getting felled up at airports and treated rudely by a bunch of Gestapo croutons. So it was difficult for me. So it was so amazing. I walked into the Portland International Airport, having been in line about 3.5 years. And it was very quiet. Of course, there's not a lot of traffic. The airport was quite empty because nobody's flying. And there was this queue, and everybody was wearing masks and looking very stressed. And then there was these announcements kept playing on the loudspeakers coming out of these, out of the ceilings. Something like you would see in the Minority Report or something, a movie for the Orwellian future or Oedipus, that things like, almost, I'm not quite exaggerating, like, fellow travelers, please be aware that wearing masks is required at all times. Report any people not protecting themselves against the COVID-19 virus. I mean, things like that. It was being echoed through the building. I went, oh, jeez, this is insane. And I was sort of watching all these people just all standing in line. And you've had some great pictures of sheep with masks on their faces on your website. And there was these hundreds of people standing in line to get scanned. And then this time, as we got closer to the TSA, sometimes it can be a little pleasant. This time they all were wearing shields around their faces, plus masks, and they were grouchy, but they were more than grouchy. They were demanding, move over here, bring your stuff here. Just like absolutely robotic. And if you look in their eyes, it almost looked like their souls have been completely ossified. I can't describe it, but it was something truly
imagine
a science fiction movie. And of course, as I go through, they said, you need to step over here. We're going to dust your hands for like a fingerprint. I said, what for? I said, I don't know what to tell you, but it's sort of like bomb residue. And I said, you're kidding me, huh? There's no.
What?
I said, go ahead. Yeah, we did. And then they asked me first, are you over 75 years old? I said, why? You don't test before 75 years old? No. I said, well, in a year and a half, a year and 4 months, I will be. That's not close enough for you. Do I look like a terrorist threat? And then they pushed me all down. And they made me give me a wallet, and I had a couple grand in there. And I said, you better come back with all the money. I don't know how much it is. They took that away, sent it back on a tray for that. It was all there with my ID. And it was just like, it was beyond insulting. It was really, it made me really angry. And, but it's a good thing I'm my age now, because I was about 25. My mind just opened up on a couple of these guys. You see, just got really arrested and in big trouble, because I felt like that. That's what it made me feel like. It's like completely outrageous. And then on the plane, they're continuing in a very gruff, and not to be crude here, because I'm not into objectifying women, but when I used to fly back when I was younger, and there were a lot of very attractive stewardesses that were turkey and cute, and now they're all not that way, and all overweight, and various forms of, different sexual persuasions, and you know what I'm talking about here, and they were gruff, and nasty, and threatening. Push a button, your seat's like, oh,
wow.
If you don't push it for you, I can tell you. A really bad attitude. I was just like, wow. So then when I got down to Las Vegas, the place was way more empty when I was there over the Labor Day weekend, like way more, because now it's cold, getting cold, and there's no anything there, there's no holidays, and that place was really empty. I forget there's like connecting to the Venetian. I walked inside there to get a cab with my daughter, and we walked. We walked to the side. They have a connecting casino that connects with the Venetian. They're part of the same, owned by Adelson, the great casino operator. And by the way, he may be selling his whole stuff at 6 cents on the dollar because they're going bankrupt. Sheldon Adelson. He's selling
on the
Venetian. About 6 cents on the dollar. They sell everything. Whole holdings there for like $6 billion. They're probably worth, because they're only as much money, he wants to get something. He's going to continue his operations in Macau, I've read, okay?
And in Asia.
All right, so in any case, I the name escapes me of the side casino. It's in conjunction, they're combined with the Venetian. I walked in that door from this corner of the street of Las Vegas Boulevard, walked into their giant gaming tables area where they play blackjack and roulette and all that. And they had about, I would guess, 250 tables there, and they all have the plexiglass screens among all the players in front of the dealer.
An exciting time was had by all.
Well, here's what was really astounding. This was something that just dropped me. I mean, out of 300 to 400 tables in this enormous gymnasium of a room, just gigantic, there were two dealers dealing out of 400 tables. I walked around the edges. There was nobody in it. But I mean nobody. Just me and my daughter and just a few players. I might have been 10 or 12 people gambling and something set up for 4 or 5,000.
What you're saying is, and I have friends down there, Las Vegas is dead. It's dying.
It's on life support.
And it may be too late. It's dead. How can this possibly come back as long as this virus is around to threaten the sheep?
Yeah, to threaten the sheep, it's not coming back. I don't know what kind of deals are cutting with the major players because they're going to lose all their fortunes. They must have made some with them. The world central banks are going to make them haul on the back end of this whole thing after they shut the whole world down. Cryptocurrency and the money or do something. Who knows what? Any case, on the way back, I spent 2 days down there. It was a little stressful, but it was good. I was very happy to leave because I could only handle a town for a few days.
Quick question.
Yeah.
The overall energy in Las Vegas is...
Overall energy is zero and very depressed in all the entertainment, gaming, resorts, hotels. All that industry is just beyond depressed and gloomy beyond words. Just really gloomy. And I mean, so gloomy that it's hard to describe. So, in any case, now I'm coming back, and my buddy dropped me off. He's my real good friend. I know he's 14 years old. He's a young kid. Everybody's a kid to me at my age, but he's in his early 40s. A great guy. And he dropped me around a bit. And he's like, cheap on taking a taxi and all that. And I know I take an Uber, so we drove me around for a couple of days, helped me out. Drove me to the airport, and he got a little bit lost because he lived there a couple of years, but he doesn't get out much around to the airport and stuff. And it's a giant complex with Karen Air Base. And he dropped me off in a bad place. I had to walk across a couple of buildings, got a little bit lost. I finally found my way into this giant inner sanctum of a massive airport. And it likewise was like really empty. I mean, there was hardly anybody. But then I worked my way up to the floor where you get your boarding pass. You type in your name, and then it goes, what airline are you on? And then you put the airline, what is your name, and what your date, and it prints out a boarding pass. Well, I thought, I even hate doing electronic stuff. I said, there must be somebody who can just deliver a ticket agent, just walk up. Well, guess what? There's none in that part at all. No, I don't think they even have them anymore. But that's not the most amazing part. The amazing part is they got all these signs for hundreds of airlines, literally, that used to come into Las Vegas. Now, they get nonstop from London and more flights in China and Japan. Three or four airports in Japan and the Philippines and South America. There's just hundreds, of, not hundreds, but dozens and dozens and dozens of airports. And they have all these machines with their names on them. So this looks like something all over the world. Independent computer terminals you punch your buttons in. And this thing probably extends, I would think, maybe 1,000 feet of that or something. I mean, there's just rows and rows and rows for these different airlines with all these mega numerous terminals for each airline. There were just thousands of them. And I was the only single person get you out of whole complex getting a boarding pass when I was there at 6:30 in the afternoon yesterday. I was the only one there at all. There was another person.
It's dead. It's dead. It's no, it's dead. It's not dying. It's dead. And it's not
dying dead. And it's not coming back. You know, and then as I walked through the mass thing, I had to wait about an hour, and so I always board last going to sort of plane. So I was
same airline going back.
Same airline going back. And they were even more gruff and nasty on the way back, but I'll get to that in a second. But in any case, that's when it really hit me. And that's why I'm going to start the program. I want to get my I hope you don't take up too much time to get my own anecdotal experience. I don't really like to do that, but
no,
that's when it hit me.
No, snapshots are important, very important.
These masks may never go away and hit me. They don't intend to, even when everybody's well. This is going to become maybe a permanent feature in the world. It causes showing complete control and obedience over people. It really hit me. I said, that's what they intend at the least. And then, on the way back, I got on the plane, and you have to keep your face covered unless you're eating or drinking. So I was drinking a bottle of some organic cranberry juice I bought in the airport, and the lady comes by and did a bunch of crap, and I said, see, I'm drinking. So we have to be drinking it regularly. I said, I'm going to take as much time as I need to drink this as I want to, and I'm not wearing a mask.
You have to keep the mask on unless you have to drink constantly. You gotta have that mask on.
Yeah, so I told her I'm not gonna do that, so you can have me arrested. I'm just gonna drink this at my leisure because I'm an old guy and I don't like to chug stuff. I can't put a beer down in 3 seconds like I did when I was 22. Okay.
I'm surprised they don't give you a straw and have you put it, tuck it under the mask and drink.
That's coming.
Right.
That's coming next. Trust me. Any case, so today I started doing the search program. I read a lot of stuff, and I subscribe to Summit News, which is Paul Joseph Watson's site, and I really always liked his gentleman. He's a great guy. He's a great journalist. He's got a great sense of humor. And he's got a whole series of articles going on about the Davos crowd and the globalist Klaus Schwab, who looks like and has a personality and face he's like the commissioner of Auschwitz or something. I mean, that's that kind of aspect. He's completely cool. And the New World Order, non-human entity. And Paul did a great job covering him. And so I'd like just to quote a few lines from this article, which is just incredible. Klaus, Dad, he came out with a book this summer called, it was published, he's ahead, by the way, of the World Economic Forum. That's the people run Davos.
Yes, that's right. No, I know who you mean.
Power source of the universe. They tell all the central banks what to do exactly. He made this assertion. He's written a book. It's a new book, came out this July, called COVID-19, The Great Reset. That's the actual title. Then he says in this book, he quotes, Klaus asserts, quote, the world will never return to normal, despite admitting that coronavirus, quote, doesn't pose a new existential threat, end quote. Goodness sakes, what does that mean? That means we've just decided to do this, and that's an excuse for it, in other words. Let me see what else he says here. Here's another quote from this character. Many of us are pondering when things will return to normal. The short response is never. Nothing will ever return to the, quote, broken sense of normalcy that prevailed prior to the crisis.
Broken sense of normalcy. Broken sense.
Broken sense. We normally conduct our lives when we have freedom. See, that's broken again. That prevailed prior to the crisis.
That's correct. You got it. Yep. That's how they think.
That's what they think is broken. People have their own privileges to run around and just be broken human beings. They don't like that at all. Because they're the control freaks, they're all control freaks. And he says, prior to the crisis, the broken central nervous system prevailed prior to the crisis because the coronavirus pandemic marks a fundamental inflection point in our global trajectory. End quote.
Look what masks do to people. We know they breed bacteria, and they can actually give you lung diseases from the bacteria in the mask. We know they also cause a loss of personality and a decoupling from your fellow man and woman. You cannot. How are you going to get to know someone in a mask environment?
You know, I'm always talking about.
I'd like to see someone's face to understand.
Of course you do. On the airplane, you're sitting two people, people in between the aisles, and the middle seats are all empty. I always talk to people on airplanes going, I'm an outgoing guy, and I'm curious, I like people a lot. You never talk to anybody. I never talk to anybody next to me, just sat her face buried in watching a movie with a mask on. Nobody looks at anybody. It's just like complete automatons getting ready to go right to the slaughter ship.
They're down. They're done. This is it. See, and the other thing is, oxygen deprivation. You're breathing carbon dioxide back in. You're no longer having the necessary oxygen for your brain to fully function. There is some talk about actual physiological brain damage from a lack of oxygen.
Of course it is. Especially if it's continual.
Let's do the break. We want to again remind all of you that these are the best products in the world that I've ever come across. They have been with this program for years, and I would deeply appreciate if you buy and send them a little note thanking them for their sponsorship and support of our First Amendment and our Constitution. Hold on, we'll be right back with Mike. What you're describing is a world that has lost a good deal of its humanity, its humility, its kindness. And what you're saying about airline stewards and stewardesses, they used to be kind and polite, and they really did enjoy their work. It sounds horrible, what you're saying. Who the hell would want to fly in that kind of an environment? Wow.
I mean, first of all, these people are working 8-10 hours just with masks on their face and walking around continuously. And all the hotel staff come in and you see the stress that causes you. Well, I never wear masks. I live in a county that doesn't require it. You can walk into several restaurants and bars in our county and nobody cares. You walk in, sit down, have a nice day. It's not enforced. Janice goes shopping, we only do it a couple times a month. I don't go, she does. I stay home and work on my land and do stuff or just trip around, you know, because I'm a man, I work for myself because I choose to. So I don't really get a chance to interface with people that's wearing masks continuously all the time, and man, it really hit me how depressing it is. It's like a prison of your lungs, of your personality.
And Aristotle found this out over 1,000 years ago. They would be prisoners to wear masks. It breaks it.
Yeah. It breaks them. Yes. You're nothing. You're just a mask. You have no soul. You have no name. You have no face. You're nobody. That's exactly what this is creating here. There's no doubt about that. Yeah, undoubtedly so. Here's a couple more last quotes here by this Klaus, piece of human excrement. He said, radical changes of such consequences are coming that sometimes are referred to as before coronavirus, BC, and after coronavirus, AC era. We will continue to be surprised by both the rapidity and unexpected nature of these changes. As they conflate with each other, they will provoke second, third, fourth, and more order consequences, cascading effects, and unforeseen outcomes.
The SOB is telling us what they've got planned.
They got tear apart. You will not believe it. I mean, we got hell on earth when we come to
the book. You remember, Mike?
Yeah, the name of the book, the name of the book you wrote, published last year, The Damage Gravity, is called COVID-19, The Great Reset, by, what's his name again, by Klaus Schwab.
When you see this guy, friends, look it up.
Take a look at his face.
Yeah.
Here's a couple of
things from this planet.
Now, this is being carried into the armed forces as well. Here's a little, I'm just reading directly from another report by Joseph Paul Watson. During a speech at the U.S. Army's annual conference, Bruce Jetta, Assistant Secretary of the Army for Acquisition, Logistics, and Technology, said that measures implemented across the country will remain in place across the defense industry to protect against the shutdown of protection facilities. He also suggested that the restrictions remain in place for the general public. Quote, I don't know that I would ever say it's totally back to normal, said Jetta. I don't see us backing off of using these same techniques on a contouring basis, even as the vaccine continues to mature. I would say we don't back off the COVID-19 standard because we'll also reduce the impact of flu and other illnesses, he added. We think continuing to apply these same techniques will be further beneficial to the people and to the Army overall.
Uh-huh.
In other words, eternal enslavement, physically, mass social distancing, everything else. Yeah.
Yes.
And... yes, so there's another thing. I mean, these two quotes are amazing. Now, here's another thing that I read from another source, but I just brought it up under Paul Watson's title. And this guy, I've never been a fan of the Catholic Church because of all their hideous actions over the last 2,000 years to destroy humanity, but this guy is pretty cool. Archbishop writes, open letter to Trump that came out, published, I believe, actually today. And this guy is quite a neat guy. It's Archbishop Carlo Maria Vergano. And,
I read it. Did you read it?
Very important. I missed that one, Jeff. I can't get all your arguments. I'll try to read them all, but I'll just read one quote for that here. He just said, we see the heads of nation and religious leaders panning to the suicide of Western culture and its Christian soul, while the fundamental rights of citizens and believers are denied in the name of a health emergency that is revealing itself more and more fully as instrumental to the establishment of inhuman faceless tyranny. That's pretty brave for a guy like that. Probably he won't be long around for too long. In any quote, the last part, the purpose of the, and this is, I think it extols what's happening here just perfectly. It really syncs it up. The purpose of the Great Reset is the imposition of a health dictatorship aiming at the imposition of the virtual silent measures hidden behind tempting promises of ensuring universal income and canceling individual debt. The price of these concessions from the International Monetary Fund will be the renunciation of private property adherence to a program of vaccination against COVID-19 and COVID-21 promoted by Bill Gates and with the collaboration of the main pharmaceutical groups.
Okay, now, you went through that very quickly. I want to go back. What they're talking about, read that more slowly, and let me just, if I may, interrupt.
Yeah, I'm sorry to confess. The purpose of the Great Reset is the imposition of a health dictatorship aiming at the imposition of the liberticidal, liberticidal measures hidden behind tempting promises of ensuring a universal basic income and canceling individual debt.
Okay, that's it. Read that last sentence. I'll share that.
Yeah, I'm ensuring universal income and cancel individual debt. In other words, it's a trade-off. You do what we tell you, and we will cancel like student debts or things, and the price of that is you will give up, you will renunciate ownership of your personal property, including real estate. He goes back.
Okay, let me back up just a little. You got it. You nailed it. Okay, I've been talking about this too. It's in his book. They're promising that they will make available to all of us debt forgiveness. especially student loan debt and all that credit card debt. I'm not sure about mortgage debt. I suspect mortgage debt. And all you have to do to get that, plus your UBI, your Universal Basic Income, right? All you have to do is sign an affidavit document that you will never own real estate for the rest of your life. You will only rent and you will only lease. And part two of that is you promise you will get the shot, the vaccine.
That's correct.
And that's all you have to do.
And you'll have it. Nothing serious. Just do not just trade your entire life for a little bit of a supposed.
Can you imagine what's in that vaccine? If you study nanotechnology, we're talking about the ability of what's in that vaccine to change your DNA, your genetics, to literally, I believe, cause your life to stop anytime they choose. Those are send and receive nanobots. They're going to attach to your central nervous system. We know where to go. And they'll just have on, literally be able to wipe out tens of millions of people in a matter of an hour just by going through and setting the right code and pushing the execute button. And I can't do it right.
Yeah, literally. So this is, you know, this is what we're up against here. We're up against a, you know, very, very, very serious enemy. And the people better start fighting back with everything they've got. One of the reasons we know for a fact, you guys know the humans. One thing about the human spirit, it's been beat down many. Throughout history, it's been beat down. It's been beat down by the Roman Empire when they conquered countries. But it's somehow the desire for freedom.
Any power structure beats it down. Even organized religion beats down
even
morality.
Yeah, that's what it does. But somehow this spirit continues to function because it's in the DNA of human beings, actually. It's a part of their karmic code, if you will. And I think
no longer after they give us the shot.
So the people are going to have to fight this. I think it'll be a massive block. I can foresee a massive block market of just Herculean proportions of people trading, owning things, doing stuff, hiding out, finding, creating, counterfeit vaccination cards, paying off barter, all that. That's what's going to happen. There's also going to be, I think it's going to be probably world violent revolution. Certainly in the country, there's a few places we can actually own weapons, which is the United States. I mean, they're not there. You know, that's why they've been trying to get rid of them for major decades, because this is what their camp always was.
Biden is allowed to get in. He has promised he's coming for our assault weapons, which are not assault weapons. They're defensive weapons with enough firepower to actually protect us.
Yes. I really doubt that anybody else ran in. Let's say we lost him. We got a fight. We know we have burglary. Here's my report. They're not turning their gold either. They're not turning their guns. I think the people, something about the people that are going to gold and guns are burglary somewhere. It doesn't matter. Some are, you know, religious or non-religious, whatever. We deal with all kinds of people. But all of these people we deal with have a very strong sense of human identity and love and freedom and independence. And it's that way all over the planet. I think in the United States, you know, I'm